Right. So I just want to, before starting, I just don't want it to be like a monologue kind of a session. So it would be interesting if, people would be interested to share their, maybe just have their videos on if possible, if they're not reluctant to start their own video, so that it won't feel like I'm talking to a screen. It will feel like I'm talking to people, I'm talking to participants here. So it would be great. Is anybody interested to turn their videos on? All right.
Friends, I request you all to kindly switch on your videos.
Yes. So, in this way, you will also feel like you're talking to somebody, you're interacting with somebody rather than just looking at some presentation. So, it would be more, it would be beneficial for both sides, So, just to understand, what's the background of the participants here? Like maybe one, two of you, if you can just pitch in and say what you're doing right now. I don't want to handpick people here, but I'm left with no choice. Okay, so
Vidit,
maybe.
yeah, please, please switch on your camera. Vidit, you can unmute yourself.
Okay, so we
Kritika
have.
Ekta.
So, okay, Kritika, what exactly do you do right now? You're studying which course? Okay, Palak is doing BTech CSE. Divya is MBA first year. All right. With that BF BTech CSE. Okay, so we have more BTech students here. Okay, all right. Got the idea. Okay, so should I start with the presentation now? I
Yes,
mean, Dr.
yeah.
Arora, you have already given an introduction about me. Just in addition to what you have mentioned, I'll just add a few more points about myself. So I've also worked with KPMG, Choice Capital, and Royal Bank of Scotland before joining EY. I have more than of 7 years of experience in corporate world in investment banking itself. I have specifically worked in mergers and acquisitions, fundraising activities, which include SME IPOs, raising funds from the private equities for the Indian as well as international market. I have built my expertise in the areas of valuation, financial model, and making presentations, which so presentations normally comes handy right from the start of a deal till the end of the deal. So I have experience in that particular area as well. And over the 7 years, I have worked with various sectors, specifically in industrials, consumers, infrastructure, and recently I've started to work in automotive sector. So when I say these sectors, basically I've worked on the deals which happen in these sectors. Academically, I've completed my MBA in finance and CFA. I'm still pursuing it. I haven't been lucky enough to complete the CFA and get the charter holder yet, but it's still in the process. As my side freelancing, I've started to work for those startups in terms of consulting. I help them with their presentations and models, which they need to prepare to present in front of the investors. So I've helped a food aggregator company, I've helped an edtech company to prepare their business presentations and to present it in front of the wider audience. So that's a little bit about me. If you think you need to connect with me, you have the LinkedIn profile link here. You can email me, you can reach out to the link on LinkedIn to me if you need any consulting, any sort of a mentorship on that front. So I'll be more than happy to help. Moving on to today's session, I would like to cover these particular topics. So basically, we will talk about what exactly is merger acquisition, what are the key drivers which drive the whole idea of mergers and acquisition. I mean, it's a very fancy word. And it's a very lengthy process. So there must be some drivers which might be, driving the company to go for mergers and acquisitions. Then there are a couple of factors like synergies, type of merger, valuation. So these are a couple of topics I'll be undertaking in today's session. If at any point in time you feel you haven't understood anything or you want a detailed understanding on particular topic, you just let me know. We can ping it in the chat and we can take it there. So let's just start. I'll keep the chat window open on one side so that I know if somebody is okay. All right. So starting with, before diving into the details, let's first understand what exactly is merger and acquisition. I mean, nowadays, these terms are used interchangeably. Mostly acquisition is a term which is used more often, more frequent. But there's a slight difference when we talk about merger and when we talk about acquisitions. So merger is basically when one company completely acquires the another company. Then it is an acquisition. But when two companies, when they're of the same size, they come together, they decide that individually they cannot exist or individually there's a difficulty for them to manage their business. So they decide to come together. And in that case, both the individual companies, they are no more into the existence. It's the final company which is formed after the merger that remains in the existence. So for example, Daimler Benz and Chrysler, they both merged and formed a new company as Daimler Chrysler. So now we don't hear Daimler Benz and Chrysler as a separate name. We just hear Daimler Chrysler, which was created out of this merger, right? So in this, both the companies' shares, stocks, they are surrendered and the new company stocks are issued in the market. All right. So that is basically merger, where it is separately owned by the new entity that is formed. In terms of acquisition, when one company, let's say buyer, acquires another company named as target and the target ceases to exist. In that case, for example, in case of Flipkart and Jabong, when Flipkart acquired Jabong, Jabong stopped being into existence in terms of a separate entity. It was a subsidiary of Flipkart post that. So then in that case, the target ceases to exist and the buyer completely swallows the entire business of the target. There's no separate existence of the target and the buyer continues to be in the existence, right? So that is a very slight difference between merger and acquisition. When it comes to the technicality, definitely it gets more technical and there are a lot many due diligence that changes at the back end. So that is something definitely there. But nowadays, acquisition has become much more common word, and especially because the startups are very commonly getting acquired, they're acquiring other companies. So we'll get into that as well. Now, moving on to this slide, I hope I'm clear in terms of, am I audible properly to everyone? Everyone is able to understand my speed of speaking, or do I need to modulate a bit?
Yeah, it's clear, Nimisha, it's clear.
Okay, all right. So basically, why do companies want to take such a big step of, you know, acquiring another company? It's a time-taking process. It's obviously it takes money. It needs a lot of financial capability to acquire another company. And it's more like a marriage. Like, you know, when you have to find a suitable prospect and you have to, you know, live the entire life with that particular prospect. So you have to think about a lot many things. So why do companies go for such a big step? One, either you feel that, you know, when you combine another company with your entity, the value of that company will be more than the separate entities. So say company A values 10 million, company B values 20 million. But when you combine both the companies, it will value more than 30 million. It will value somewhere around, say, 40 million, 50 million. So when you see that, you know, that together you make much more difference, together your value is much more higher than existing as a separate entities, then you want to, you know, acquire another company. You want to exist together rather than existing as separate companies. So that is a major key driver for the company to buy another company, right? Synergies, it's a topic in itself. I'll take it in detail in the next slide. So for right now, we'll just park it on the side. Moving on to the next point, cannot survive alone. Again, there are many companies who are, you know, whose fixed costs are very high. Let's say, take an example of telecom sector. They have such a huge cost when it comes to laying down the cables, laying down the network stations and the spectrums. So it's very expensive affair, right? So, and we have seen that, you know, recently telecom has been the most suffered sector, if we can take it that way. Now there are only 2 to 3 major companies which we hear. Maybe we hear BSNL, government's BSNL is there, Airtel is there, and Vodafone is there. Rest, we don't even hear those names, right? Because the smaller companies, they cannot survive in this kind of a sector where, you know, there's a lot of expenditure, capex in terms of fixed assets. There's a fixed cost is very high, right? So here again, like, you know, when these companies, when they're difficult to survive, because they have to cater to the wider market to at least earn some revenue to become profitable. But for that, they need to diversify. In the sense, they need to have larger market. Say a company, say, let's say Vodafone, if it is catering only to Delhi, will it survive? The kind of cost it incurs to do the basic setup that will not satisfy just one market. So to cover the whole India, do they have the capability to just do it alone? Can they do it alone? Or do they need somebody to help them out, right? That is a reason you will see many transactions happening in the telecom sector, and not just in India. Even at international level, you will see there are only major 4 to 5 players who are there. And why is that? Why are there not 20 players, 30 players in this sector, right? So we will see that, you know, Vodafone acquired Idea to cover up much more larger spectrum, to have much wider expansion. So this is one of the reasons that, you know, companies definitely acquire another company, because they cannot survive alone. If we talk about to kill competition, we saw the example of Flipkart, right? There was a point in 2014 when we can say there was a hype of e-commerce industry, especially e-retails. There were so many small players were there. Jabong itself was a separate company. Myntra was there. There were many small e-retailers. But now if you see, we hear only 2 to 3 names. Again, Flipkart is there. Now definitely it got acquired by Walmart. So Flipkart has become little on the backside. But still, Flipkart was there, Amazon, Avid, and Paytm as well, right? So these were the only 3 companies which we started to hear of late. So what these companies did, they killed the competition. Even if somebody wanted to enter the market, these companies became so big in size that those small companies couldn't survive. So they had to, you know, sell them off to these bigger players in the market. And that's how the competition was killed, right? Another reason for companies to go for mergers and acquisitions are diversification. There are so many companies who don't want to just exist in one particular aspect. They want to cater to different markets. If we take an example of Tata, Tata is a well diversified company. It's into hotel business, it's into automobiles, it's into IT. So, you know, there are so many different sectors Tata is diversified into. Like that, nowadays, considering, like, let's say pandemic happened, COVID happened. If you just have one revenue stream, and what if that particular scenario hits your business badly? Do you have a second revenue stream? You don't, right? Unless you diversify. So companies which are well diversified, for them, it becomes much easier to manage the the seasonal changes or these pandemic situations where you have different revenue streams. So definitely, companies who want to play safe, they don't want to be, master of one particular business. They want to diversify. They go for acquisitions. Acquisition of assets. So you take banks. Banks had been very traditional in way of their working so far, before the digitization really came into picture. Like, you know, after demonetization, things started to become more digital. Everything went on the Paytm wallet, Airtel Money. Everything was becoming wallets and e-payments and online payments, right? So in those cases, banks realized that they need to upskill themselves. They just cannot just exist as a simple physical structure. So now at this point, they cannot just start from scratch building their own digital world. They need to find some company which is already there in existence. They have a well-built technology in place and they can just acquire those companies. So nowadays, banks are doing this. They are acquiring other companies. They are acquiring who are into wallets, who are into online payments. So like, you know, PayNemo is there. There are so many merchant banks are there. So they acquire these companies, right? So that's another reason, acquisition of an asset. Increasing financial capacity. when there's a small company, if it goes to the bank, it might not get, you know, the sufficient funding it needs. If I need 50 crores and my company size is only 10 crores, probably it will not give me more than, you know, 8 crores or 7 crores, right? 80% of my company's value. But if I acquire another company and if my company's value becomes 50 crores or 60 crores, then I can easily get funds from the bank at the level of 40 crores. Right. So that's another reason that companies acquire another company, that their financial capability increases. They can get more money and at a lesser interest rates. You might know this concept of, right, when you are a bigger player, when you are more established, you get finances at a lesser interest rates because the risk is less. Right. So that's another reason the companies go for acquisitions. There are tax reasons. If I want to reduce my taxes, though it's not one of the very favorable route, but normally what companies do, they buy another company which are loss-making companies. They'll acquire those companies because they're loss-making. They have, you know, taxes carry forwards, so they don't have to pay any taxes. They have a negative tax carry forwards. So when I acquire these companies, my tax liability reduces, right? So that's another reason companies will get acquired by such tax loss-making companies. And the last point here to discuss is incentives for managers. So incentives for managers, what this could be? Anybody wants to chip in here and talk about this? That how can merger and acquisition be an incentive for managers? Like, you know, those top management people. Why this will be an incentive for them? Anybody? I mean, any faint point, you know, it doesn't have to be right. Anybody wants to give a shot on this? Incentives for managers, what kind of incentives can be beneficial for the managers to go for M&A?
Ma'am, we can say that because of mergers or acquisitions, managers may get an incentive that the scope of their working would increase. That if a company is getting merged with another company, so maybe that second company which they're getting merged with, they provide better benefits or they get better environment for it than the original company was giving them.
Definitely. May I know who was speaking right now?
Ma'am,
Hi Inderjot. That was correctly said. That was right, bang on the point. So basically for managers, definitely the incentive is the company will become bigger, right? They'll get much more work to take care of. They'll have more power in their hands, definitely, because now the company has become bigger, so they'll be more powerful. Also, compensation-wise, that is also linked for the managers. If the company has become bigger, say if I have done one merger and I've taken the company to another level, so I'll get more compensation, or my compensation will be linked to the size of the company. So there are companies, you know, which want to just grow further. That's why they can just, their compensations are linked like that, right? So any clarifications on these points, or should I move to the next slide?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Is there a guarantee for job security for the manager? Isn't it a point to be considered by them?
Correct. So we will also see in one of the slides later that at times what happens, the security of manager's job is also, you know, it also comes into the risk zone, because when somebody wants to acquire, say, suppose I want to acquire another company, but I don't want the top management of that particular company. So I'll let them go, right? So in that case, then what happens if I am letting those management goes? Obviously their job is at risk, right? So those, I'll discuss that point in one of the slides, how can these managers' job can be secured. But definitely that is one point that can be taken up. And but apart from that, normally when we talk about incentives for managers, it is basically that, you know, it will be in their contract. Like, you know, if the company has grown to this particular X revenue size, then the manager will get this compensation. Say the CEO will get this compensation, right? So in those cases, it is a lucrative offer for the CEO to acquire another company and just, you know, increase the revenue in a year's time, right? So that's the thing. All right. So moving on to the next slide, premium factor synergy. So this is the point that I left it on the slide. The reason I am taking synergies as one separate point is synergy is a major factor which determines the mergers and acquisitions. So it's basically when you acquire another company, there is a financial term that you will look at. How much profit are you going to make out of this merger? And that cannot be just based on this year's financial numbers. Like, you know, if the company is making, say, 100 million revenue this year, but can you decide if the company will be profitable for you just on the basis of that particular number for this year? You cannot. You need to know for next 4-5 years how the company is going to perform. So you need to know what kind of synergies you will get by acquiring that particular company. So synergies is basically how much money you will make after paying extra money to that particular acquisition. Say, for example, if my company is $100 million, the target is $50 million. I paid $60 million for the acquisition of the target because you'll pay some premium to the target more than what the company is valued at. So then you need some amount of synergies to balance that amount that you have paid, right? 10 million that you have paid extra. You need to value whether that company is justified to pay that 10 million or not. So the synergies have to be more than 10 million. Okay. So basically synergies, how do we calculate that? Synergies basically we calculate on the basis of cost synergies and revenue synergies. So we either look at cost that, you know, when I'm acquiring another company, there are departments which will be redundant. For example, there's a HR department which might be redundant. There might be some operational department, finance department. So all, because every company has these departments. So when you acquire another company, you will want to reduce the these departments. You would want to streamline them. So obviously there'll be staff reduction. There'll be bargaining with the suppliers, in the sense when you become bigger, you'll have a more bargaining power with the suppliers. The product that you were procuring at, say, at X amount of money, you can procure it at a lesser amount of money because your order size is big and you're a bigger company in the market. Processes get streamlined, so you save money there also. So you try to put a number to that particular cost synergies that, okay, I'll be saving, say, $5 million from this particular cost synergies. Likewise, for the revenue synergies, you try to see, if you are acquiring a company, are you acquiring it for geographical expansion? You are in Delhi, you want to expand to UP, you want to expand to Maharashtra, you'll acquire another company which has presence in Maharashtra or has presence in UP. So likewise, you will see how much extra revenue you are generating by expanding in those three areas. You will look at new technology that you are acquiring for. You will look at the market reach and, you know, how much visibility you are having. So basically, there's a term called economies of scale. I'm sure there are a couple of students here who are from BBA and BCom. You would have heard this term called economies of scale. Or in MBA also, I remember being taught this term in MBA as well, economies of scale. Anybody can pitch in for economies of scale, what exactly it is. So the reason I'm trying to ask these questions so that I know, you know, people are interactive and you're not just dozing off in the middle of the session post lunch. So let's try to keep it interactive.
Ma'am, we can say that economies of scale is basically that because mass production level, my cost, the producer's cost of production reduces.
Great. That is perfectly right point. Again, so the person whosoever is speaking, just tell the name before speaking because I'm unable to see who is talking actually, you know.
Ma'am, Indrajot.
Okay. So we have one interactive person here, right? Okay. So Indrajot, you're totally right on this point. So when we increase the production, our cost gets minimized. If I have set up a machinery, it will be a fixed cost for me. But if I'm producing 100 soaps on that, or if I'm producing 10,000 soaps on that, so it will definitely decrease my per unit cost when I'm increasing my production. So this is also what companies get the synergies out of, when they're saving money here and they're making revenue, they're making more revenue by decreasing the per unit cost, right? So you give a number to these cost synergies and the revenue synergies that you generate by acquiring another company. And this synergy determines how much premium you will pay to buy another company. Okay. I can hear some background noise. Yeah. Right
now. Rahul, can you check, Rahul? Yeah, please, Nimisha. Yeah.
Okay. So the thing is, when we put a number to these particular synergies, we get an idea that how much premium we are paying for that particular company. Is that justifiable or not? So if I'm paying $50 million, I should at least get 50 million of synergies from that company so that my cost is taken care of. It's as simple as whatever I'm spending, am I getting profit out of it or not, right? So synergies is a major factor that the companies look at. They estimate this number, whether they are making money on it or not. And accordingly, they basically take the call that, okay, now this is perfectly fine. We can go ahead with this merger. So for example, let's take an example here, Zomato and Swiggy, right? They're in the same business operation line. They are delivering the food. They're a food delivering app, but there's a stiff competition between them, right? Now, hypothetically, what if Zomato and Swiggy, they acquire each other, if they get merged, will there be any synergies in the acquisition? Definitely there will be, because, you know, they'll reduce their operational overlaps. Agar, like, you know, if Zomato is catering to entire, say, north region, and there is Swiggy, which is catering to the south region, right? If that demarcation is done, then you can save on the operational level that, okay, Zomato will cater only to the north region and Swiggy will cater only to the south region, right? So in that case, the person from north will not have to run after to deliver an order for the south region. He can just take care of the north area, and the south area Swiggy can take care of. So like this, they can save a lot of money on the operational front, on the manpower that is required, on the inefficiencies which come into picture. So these all factors will determine the synergies that they can drive if Zomato and Swiggy combine, right? So this is what happens when two startups or they combine and they try to see synergies that they can generate from that particular acquisition. And that is how that amount is decided. The amount that I'm paying, whether it is, so this is what we also do, right? When we go and buy a product, we try to see value for money. That's a term. Value for money is the right term for basically saying synergies. You try to see what is the value for money for that particular company, for that particular acquisition that you're making. Okay. All right. So let's go to this. So this, I'll just quickly go through the different types of merger that normally happens. One is horizontal merger. Horizontal merger is basically when you are in a particular business line, you acquire another company in the same business line, and you just expand in terms of different products in the same sector, different market area in the same sector, just as I gave the example of Zomato and Swiggy. Vertical merger is when you are, say, when you are into the B2C business and you want to get into the B2B. That will be a vertical merger. Say I am a retail outlet right now and I start manufacturing as well. That will be a vertical merger. In forward integration, I am a raw material provider. I get into the retail outlet. So that is a forward integration. Backward integration is when I'm a retail outlet and I start manufacturing the product or I start making the raw material. Then it's a backward integration. Again, the concept stays same, that everybody is looking for synergies. Everybody is looking for expansion. All the drivers come into picture when they're integrating either forward or backward. Conglomerations, biggest example is Tata. Biggest examples are these all, big houses that are there, like Reliance, which are into different kind of businesses, like Reliance recently acquired Future Retail. So that's diversification. So such conglomerates is another type of a merger. Reverse merger might be a new term. I'm not sure how many of you have heard reverse merger. Reverse merger is basically when a private company buys a public company to become public. So there's one, what is the way basically to become a public company? I think it's a very common term which is used in Indian stock market. How can a company become public? Anybody? What's the route of becoming a public company? Okay. In the interest of time, I'll just go ahead with it. So basically, normally companies go through IPO. They do initial public offerings through which they become public, right? They start trading on the stock market. But when somebody, and it's a very long process, trust me, it takes a year. It takes a lot of approvals from SEBI, from different regulators that, you know, an IPO comes into picture. So what if a private company wants to get public, but doesn't want to go through the detailed process of IPO? This is another route. Acquire a public company through reverse merger and become public. So the public company ceases to exist and the private company becomes the public company. All right. So that's how the reverse merger comes into the picture. All right. So I'm sure you guys would have gone through valuations sessions before, and it might have been specific to startups. So there's a difference when you do a valuation for startups and when you do valuation for the growth companies, growing, you know, which are already in the growth stages. For the companies which are in the seed stage or pre-seed stage or ideation stage, they have a different level of valuations. They are valued basically on certain revenue multiples or by post-money, pre-money valuations by using scorecards, or you can say Burkus method. You know, those are the methods that you normally use for the early stage companies. But when it comes to the growth companies, when I say growth companies, I basically mean that you have a fixed revenue stream. You have a growing revenue stream. You have started to show positive in terms of your profitability. So when we have a positive profit numbers, these are the few valuation metrics that we look at when we value a company. So one, we go through comparable ratio. We look at EV revenue, EV by revenue. That's an enterprise value. That is a complete value of the company by revenue. EV by EBITDA, price by earnings, and price by books. So these are 3-4 ratios that we look at. Now, how do we arrive at these ratios? We analyze the two things. One, either you look at precedent transactions, which is if, you know, similar transactions have happened in the industry. If I have to look at Flipkart Jabong, or if I have to look at Baiju Akash transaction, then probably I'll look at more acquisitions that has happened in the edtech sector. I'll analyze what kind of valuation was given to these companies and at what multiple did they sell, right? So when I have an average number for the multiple, I'll apply that to my company's revenue. Say if I'm looking at EV by revenue, I'll multiply that particular multiple to my revenue and I'll see what is my value of the company. So if my company is generating a revenue of $5 million and the multiple in the market is at say 10x for the EV by revenue, then I'll get a $50 million valuation for my company. So that's how we value the growth companies, growth stage companies. There are comparable companies. So we also look at the publicly traded companies in the similar businesses. Those are big companies compared to the startup companies. So we put a discount there to the number that arrives, and then we multiply that number with the revenue or EBITDA numbers of our own company. That's how we get the multiples from company comparables and precedent transactions. There's a third multiple that we also analyze is industry multiples. At times what happens, like say companies which are into digital space, they don't have a positive positive profit, and they cannot, it won't be right also to measure them at the profit level. So then we look at the number of clicks that has happened, that has generated the revenue. So we will analyze the revenues generated by the per click or the per advertisement that has been posted on the social media. So we'll have to look at the different industry multiples in such niche industries where you cannot just look at the revenue and the profit numbers. So we will look at, say for example, if you're looking at a retail outlet, how much sale they are making. So we will analyze, say, EV by per square foot. So we'll look at the revenues that they have generated from each square foot of area, and we will consider that as a multiple and we'll put that to our revenue numbers, right? So that's how we look at the different sort of valuation numbers. There's this one another technique that we use. It's a very detailed technique called discounted cash flow. We normally do these kind of valuations when we have 4-5 years of financials in our hands. We have 4-5 years of historical financials that we have, on the basis of which we build out futuristic financials for next 3 years, we discount that and come up with the present value of that particular company. That what this company might value at basis their financials, which I anticipate for next 3 years, right? So this is a little technical thing here. So if somebody is interested, we can take it offline and we can discuss it in details. Okay. This is the overall deal process. There's nothing to like really talk about here. It's very crystal clear in the presentation that we have to have a strategy. First of all, why we need to acquire a company? Am I looking at a geographical expansion, or am I looking at a product expansion, or I want to go to international markets? So you need to have a strategy very clear in your head. Why you want to get acquired, or why you want to acquire? There has to be a criteria that, okay, this is a revenue criteria I'm looking at, that I can acquire a company which is making a $5 million to $10 million kind of a business. Searching potential targets. Once we have the criteria ready, that I'm looking in this market, I'm looking for this particular sector, and I'm looking at this revenue level. Then you start looking out for the targets which are there in the market, right? Then you plan that how you're going to execute this particular deal. You sign a purchase and you start making the NDAs and the sale purchase contracts. You do a due diligence. Then there's a negotiation round where you negotiate at the valuation. Obviously, the buyer would want to reduce the valuation. The target would want to increase the valuation so that there is more money on the table. So you decide that, you know, you have to come down to a point or come down to a particular value. Then there's valuing and evaluating after doing that. So you sign a purchase contract, and then financial strategy, how you're planning to merge the companies. And lastly, how to close and integrate. So you won't believe there's a separate in most of the big companies, like, you know, the diversified big houses, they have a separate post-merger integration team who helps them into integrating the acquired companies, because 70 to 90% of the deals fail because they were not able to integrate properly in the existing business. And they could not successfully, generate the synergies that they had calculated. So definitely integration is a big aspect, right? This is just a kind of a snapshot of this whole deal process, that once you have a target in place, you know, that this is a target I want to reach out to, you give them an offer that, okay, this is my offer, this is the value I'm looking at, and this is I want to acquire. Now the target has an opportunity to respond to the offer in three ways. One, either accept the terms, right? They accept everything that is written on the tender offer, that, okay, we are fine with the valuation, we are fine with the terms, everything that is mentioned in the tender offer. So they can just simply accept the offer. Second, they can attempt to negotiate. And third, they can, you know, defend themselves that they don't want to get acquired. In the cases, there are hostile acquisitions as well, where the buyer forcefully buys the target company, right? So to avoid that, there are a couple of defense mechanisms that the company follows. There is poison pill, golden parachute, super majority provisions. These are the pre-defense mechanisms. There are post-offer defense mechanisms. You can simply say, no, I'm not interested in this particular deal. Okay, there's an interesting term called Pac-Man. Has anybody heard, or I'm sure most of you would have played Pac-Man games during their childhoods. Anybody can talk about Pac-Man? What's this game about? Anyone? Just take a shot. I'm sure this is not something difficult. Anybody wants to give a shot at what exactly is Pac-Man game? I'm sure most of you would have played. I have played during my childhood, Pac-Man. So you remember Pac-Man basically had this thing that the Pac-Man had to eat all the pellets and had to save itself from the ghost. But if the ghost eats the pellet, the Pac-Man can eat the ghost as well. So the same strategies applied in the acquisition market as well. If the buyer, say company A, has offered hostile takeover tender offer for the target, can, you know, offer in return can also offer to acquire the buyer. So that's a retaliation. In such a scenario, that's called a Pac-Man. And in real life scenario, Porsche and Volkswagen actually went through the same strategy, same kind of an acquisition. Porsche, during 2005 to 2012, this was in a limelight, that Porsche offered a hostile takeover on Volkswagen. In 2008, there was a financial crisis and Porsche was going through a real bad time. Their financials were gone. They had a huge liability on their head. So Volkswagen counter offered Porsche and there was no choice left for Porsche and but to get acquired by Volkswagen. So this was a Pac-Man strategy that was followed by Volkswagen and finally it acquired Porsche. So this deal is live. This is live when it happened, right? Moving on to the next point. Once the target accepts the response, there's a closing of deal. So the transaction can be done cash for stock. So either you can do the transaction by giving cash and receiving the stocks, or you can do a stock to stock transaction where you exchange the stocks of your company for the stocks of another company. That's how you buy. And there's an exchange ratio that comes into picture there, that how much your shares will be exchanged in exchange to the stocks that you buy for the other company. And it can be cash as well as stocks, both, right? All right. These are certain terms that till now we have heard of mergers and acquisitions where the companies are buying another company or they're acquiring another company, they're getting merged. There are a few terminologies that we use when a bigger house, bigger conglomerate, so when they hive off their business, this is called divestitures. So in divestitures, there are spin-offs, split-offs, equity carve-out. So these are just the different technicalities that are used by the big houses to hive off their business. So just to give a brief idea on spin-off, split-off, and equity carve-out, basically creating the subsidiary as a new entity and giving its shares to the existing shareholders in the parent company. If I hold the parent company's shares, I'm getting the shares of the existing of the subsidiary unit that they have hived off, right? So there are different technical stuff here, but let's move to more important aspect which comes to Indian startups. I think you guys will be more interested in these slides. So now, if I look at the last 2 years, specifically last year since the COVID started, it was a very tough time for, I say, entire economy, but specifically for the startups, because they just started to establish and they just started to maybe started clocking revenues when the pandemic started and, you know, they started to suffer. So we saw that, you know, fundings went down. Investors were not keen to sign the checks because everybody was risk averse. Nobody wanted to take the risk. They don't know whether the business will survive post-COVID or not. So definitely fundings went down. 40% of the startups were negatively impacted. 15% of the startups, they had to close down their businesses. I recently worked with a food aggregator company, and it works with IRCTC. And for last 1.5 years, they didn't have any revenue. And now they've got the funding from Feb 2020 when the trains started to run, right? Then after that, only they started to get fundings as well. So definitely a very tough time for the startups. Investors had higher negotiation power because obviously we are in the need of money and the investors are the ones who will be writing checks. So they definitely have the higher hand. They had the upper hand to negotiate on the valuation. They got lesser, they bought the shares, they got the equity stakes for at lesser valuations, right? But as soon as the economy opened up, as soon as the lockdown was over, demand increased, investors started to show positive sentiments and they started to fund the companies. And specifically, we saw that there was a huge shift in the digital consumption, right? In everything, people were more comfortable to order online, get it delivered than to move out. Be it the payments they did online, be it the food, be it groceries, be it the medicines, anything and everything moved to digital scenario, right? So there were certain sectors which really picked up in the digital scenario. One was education. We saw how Baiju, Vedantu, there are so many companies who came into picture. They took care of the the gap that was created because the university shut down and universities were shut down and the students could not go to the universities, colleges, schools to complete their education. So definitely these companies came up and catered to that gap. But there were a couple of sectors like travel, hospitality, mobility. These definitely suffered. Entertainment sector definitely suffered. We still see that, you know, people are not much keen to go to the cinema halls and watch a movie. They would want to stay safe, right? So there are still certain sectors. So this pandemic has opened eyes for us. We need to see which sector we are, you know, we want to do our business in. So this is what I've, at least personally, this is what I've understood. As long as your products and services are related to or are catering to the basic needs of an individual, it will help, it will sustain. But if it is luxurious, if it caters to leisure, it is difficult to comment whether, you know, it will sustain, whether it will continue to grow, because we don't know, considering we actually thought that this COVID might be just over in 2021, will be good, right? But still continued. And right now we can see the pandemic at a different level altogether, right? So we don't know how the companies will perform. Nobody can comment. But yes, we should definitely, one, we should definitely try to cater to the basic needs, basic problems, without which people cannot survive, without which people cannot go through their day. So we should try to find solutions for such problems. Two, there should always be an alternative revenue stream. Your business should not rely on one revenue stream. Because if something goes wrong, there's some glitch in that one particular revenue stream, you need to have another one. If you take a very small example of Domino's, Domino's is into pizzas, right? We all know it's plain purely into pizzas. But if you see last 1 year's performance, Domino's, I remember analyzing that company 10 months ago, before, during the lockdown, or you can say when the lockdown just started, it was trading at 1700. And today that company is trading at 2800. And the only reason is because the company, you know, sailed along with the flow of the waters. It started another side business, another segment, which is called ready to make pasta sauces or another sauces, which they started to deliver to people because they were staying at home and they wanted to make, they were making food at home. So because they understood the problem that people have to stay back at home, they don't have so much of time to cook, so they came up with a ready to make sauces that they just have to mix that and start making their, they can make their food, right? This particular business took care of the losses that they were making on their pizza business. And that is how they sailed through this particular situation, right? So definitely we need to know where are we, what kind of business we are in, and do we need to have another alternative revenue stream that can cater to our main primary source, right? Doctor, how much time do we have left? Do I have some time to cover these three slides?
Yes, we can cover. We have 10-15 minutes.
Yeah. All right. So that's how little rushing.
Session is going to, it is very interesting session. Miss, I am learning a lot.
I'm definitely grateful that you're finding this session interesting. I hope other participants also find this interesting. And definitely if there's anything I can, guide you on post the session also, I'm more than available offline on the LinkedIn, on my email. You can reach out to me so we can have more discussions on it. So thanks. Yes. So now, how does M&A help the startups? Now comes the real part. So now, as we understood that, so many, we will see that even during pandemic times, definitely deals went down, right? Because there were many startups who were able to sail through the tough times. They came out of the tough times and they managed their own business. But still, there were many businesses who started to face a lot of issue in the operations front. They did not have sufficient funds. Investors were not ready to write the checks. So now, after the lockdown, after this whole lockdown got over, we could see that suddenly there was a deal increase in the deal sizes. There was increase in the number of deals that happened in Indian market specifically. we would see that, you know, Baiju itself acquired so many companies in last 1 year. We'll be surprised to see that, you know, how come suddenly the company is so active, right? But we could see it was a lucrative time for the buyers because they were getting companies at a lower price and they were easily able to expand by acquiring these companies. And the target companies, they were low on cash. They did not have sufficient fund to operate their business. So they exited their business and they got acquired by the bigger players, right? So what could be the reasons again that motivating factors for the startups to get acquired? They were running low on cash, right? Like Flipkart did, there were many players in the market. So they started acquiring another company so that they are the bigger fish in the market and they can kill other competitors. Plugging in the gaps of digitization like banks did by acquiring tech-based kind of assets. There were tech acquisitions as well. Like, you know, there are so many edtech companies are acquiring each other, right? Last to last year or 3 to 4 years ago, you can say, e-commerce companies were the major drivers in the whole startup scenario. But this year, we can see that edtech company is on the top notch. We will see so many transactions. If you look at the next slide, you'll see these are the transactions that happened in the last 5 months in the startup scenario. And most of them, you'll see Upgrad. This is a edtech company. Veranda Learnings is an edtech company. Lead School is an edtech company. Upgrad. You see Stones to Milestones, Baiju. There's so many Unacademy, so many edtech companies which acquired, you know, which did acquisitions. So this shows that, you know, this there was a gap in this sector which was not catered. Nobody anticipated that at some point of time, colleges will close. Universities won't be, you know, won't be catering to the students. There won't be schools for a year because students cannot stop learning, right? There has to be a certain way to continue for them to continue learning. So this is what Baiju or these edtech companies, they found this gap that we need to fill this gap. And that's how Baiju last year it acquired White Hat Junior. Nowadays, if you see in the corporate world, coding is one of the very important learning or skill you can see that is required. So it acquired White Hat Junior, which is expert in coding. Apparently, there have been a lot of issues that came up with White Hat Junior. But Baiju, instead of building its own segment into coding, it acquired White Hat Junior for some $300 million in 2019. And it got another segment in its business, right? This year itself, it bought Akash Institutes. You all are aware of Akash Institutes, how famous it is, right? For all the preparations and all. It did $1.1 billion of investment, $1 billion investment on Akash Institute, and it bought this company. This company, Baiju, has made 11 acquisitions in history. It started in 2011. It made 11 acquisitions so far. Out of which, in total, $1.5 billion, out of which $1 billion was spent on Akash Institutes. But by acquiring Akash Institutes, understand that, you know, they have captured such a big market. Baiju has become a decacon. There's a term called decacon. You guys must be aware of it. There's a unicorn and then there's a decacon when the company turns over $10 billion. Right, this company stands at $15 billion today next to Paytm, which is $16 billion company. So this happened because it recently acquired another company. It got fundings at the higher rounds of valuations. Its market size expanded leaps and bounds by acquiring this company, right? So this is what happens in the M&A scenario. Though it is good, but you have to take a calculative decision that why you want to acquire this company, why you want to go for this route. We should not follow the herd mentality, which we have a tendency to follow. Like, okay, if this person is doing MBA, I should also do MBA. If this person is doing CFA or the mass is doing CFA, I should also do CFA. This is the normal mentality, right? But we cannot do that in mergers and acquisitions. We have to have our own gut feeling there, whether we want the company to go pursue this route or not, right? It might just go wrong at any point in time. And you're spending a lot of money or you're spending the hard earned money here. So definitely have to be really sure. So what all factors we can ensure to make sure that, you know, the acquisition, the merger happened successfully and it did generate the synergies, the value that we calculated when we are acquiring the company. So there are a couple of strategies that we need to follow while we are going for the acquisition, right? As a buyer, you need to consider the fitness of that particular company in your business, right? If you think, or even as a target, if you want that, you know, you want to get acquired by a bigger player or some other company, you need to see whether you want to be part of the company, you want to exit completely. So there are different factors that will play into role if you want to be part of that company. Then you will have to understand the buyer equally as the buyer will have to understand your company, right? If you're exiting, then it's more about valuation, that what money you are getting on the shares that you're holding. So if you just talk about from the perspective of buyers, there are a couple of pre-merger strategies and a couple of post-merger strategies that we need to follow, right? If we look at, let's talk about consider the fit. I'm just looking at a few points just to make sure that I've covered up all. Yeah, so when we talk about consider the fit, in that case, you need to see whether when I'm buying that company, am I getting the required revenue? What is the agenda that I'm buying that company for? Is it the revenue? Is it the market presence? Is it the customer base that I'm looking for? Whether this will fit my company or not, whether it will cater to my requirements or not. So you need to understand the fitment of that particular company, not fitness, right? Listen to the seller. So you need to understand the seller, like, you know, that particular person has built that company from scratch. For that seller, it's a baby. So it's just not the financial aspect that needs to be catered to. There are some non-financial concerns as well that the seller might have, right? So you need to understand that, what the seller is really looking for. It can be a deal breaker. So, you know, you've already invested in so many aspects, but you have not understood the seller, the deal might just be called off and it might just not happen. Right? Hit the books. Due diligence is the most important aspect. You can never be too sure that what the company looks like from inside, because you're an outsider. You have to be very sure what all financials are there, how the books look like, how the balance sheets looks like. Are they true numbers or are they fabricated numbers? You have to understand the accounting, spot checks. You need to talk, you should just talk to everybody who's involved in that company in the terms of the customers, vendors, suppliers, neighbors, employees, because they are the right ones who will give you the right picture about the company. How about you plan that you buy a company, you will retain the CEO of the company, but the CEO of the company is not the right person, right? Only the employees can tell you that, how the CEO of their company is. And you might just save yourself by before landing up into the wrong deal, right? So you need to understand all of that. The more you know, the lesser surprises you will get. And it's better to be less surprised. Develop a game plan. You should always have a game plan when you're acquiring a company. How you plan to merge that? What all operations do you need to get rid of? What all estimates you can have? Which department you want to club together? Which segment you want to, you know, put this new acquisition? Which segment you want to align it with? So you need to have a game plan. It's just like having the architect prepare the whole layout for you before building the house. Unless you have the whole layout in front of you, you won't know where the pipes are, where the electric cables are, where the wires are. You won't know anything. And the day something goes wrong, you won't know how to fix it, right? So you should have a game plan for sure. You should trust your guts. We all say, right, my instincts are saying to do this, my instincts are saying not to do this. Trust me, you should always believe that. Everything might seem right, but something might just not smell right inside your head. You might feel like something is not right. I'm not getting the good vibes. Go for it. You should listen to it. You should not put it aside. When it comes to post-merger, after you have clubbed the companies together, culture is the most important thing. There are so many companies after getting acquired, you know, it has gone down the drain. the most famous example was Google and Nest. Google acquired Nest for $32 billion, right? Or 3.2 billion. I'm not sure about the number here, but that company acquired Nest and there was a difference in the culture. Google is an open culture. Google is more of bottom to top approach. Nest is top to bottom approach. It's a single leader driven company. It did not work out properly. Google provided all sort of support to Nest, but Nest had a different way of functioning. It did not work out, and they had to sell off Nest after a couple of years because it just did not work out. So you would not want to acquire a company and just sell it off because it's a loss-making decision, right? So culture is a very important thing. How you are driving your company, how the other company is being driven, it makes a huge difference. Another example is Benetton. Benetton is an Italian clothesline business, right? It acquired a ski boots making company, Nautica. And what happened there? So Benetton is based out of US, and Nautica was based out of Nordics country. Now the problem was the culture. Nautica employees were called to join their company in New Jersey. And the culture difference that they had when they were staying there in Nordics and they came to New Jersey, all the employees were, you know, they were heartbroken. They could not stay with the company and they left the company and the transaction was a fail. In Nordica, there was a habit, you know, after lunch, they'll go for a ski. And when they came to join Benetton, they did not have such culture. So definitely there was a huge gap in terms of culture and the deal fell apart. They had to sell off the business because Benetton, from making a $5 million kind of a revenue from the profit, they went to 30 million loss-making company only because of this cultural difference. So we need to see with whom we are getting acquired, who is acquiring us, is the cultural lines are similar or not. It makes a huge difference. Asset versus stock, when you're buying the assets of a company, you're just buying the assets. But when you're buying the stocks, you mean you're taking the liability as well of that particular company on your books. So you need to see, you need to structure your transaction, whether you're just buying the asset or you're buying the complete company. When you're buying the complete company, the baggage is also there. So you need to see if that baggage makes sense to include or not, whether it is more worthwhile to buy the whole company or just the asset. Tax implications. Obviously, that comes into picture when you're acquiring a company, when you're selling a company, there are a lot of tax regulations that comes into picture. So you need to understand that. And last but not the least, financial expectations. What happens when you're acquiring a company, you have a set of financial expectations from the company. The culture is right, the culture is right, the books are good, due diligence are perfect, you had a game plan of 5 to 10 years. On the basis of the finances. What if the company underperforms? Something went wrong and the company underperforms. That deal is definitely broken down. What if it overperforms? You think that if it overperforms, it will be a good thing, right? But trust me, there was a live deal that happened, Reddit and Condnast. Condnast acquired Reddit in 2006 and Reddit was a 100x growing company at that point in time. It grew at 100x. And that company was bought at $20 million by Condnast. Condnast couldn't provide the kind of resources Reddit needed to grow because it was growing leaps and bounds. So it couldn't provide that resources. It couldn't provide that finances, that funds. At the end, after a year, Reddit got hived off so that it can capture the future opportunities because along with Condnast, it was not able to do that. So again, financial expectations, underperformance, definitely it's a no-no. But when it is overperforming, you need to analyze, is your company fit to take or is it ready to absorb that kind of overperformance? So that's it from my end. These are the couple of sources that I refer to come up with these contents. If you want, you can also leverage these sources to have more understanding on the topics that I've covered. And if anybody has any questions, I can take it up.
A great session, Isha. Actually, really great session. Means I have learned a lot.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Any questions from the participants?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
I would like to ask that.
Pala, can you give us your introduction, please?
Yes, sir. So I'm Palak Mahajan in first year CSC BTech. I'm from IGDTOW.
Hi, Palak. Yeah, tell me.
Okay. Ma'am, I would like to ask that if a company is ready to be acquired by a bigger company, the stakeholders or the managers there or the CEO, let's say CEO of the company, how will they consider or how will they make sure that the privileges they have to decide the fate of the company or the decision making power they had, how much it will survive or how much it will be supported by the company they want to make the they want to make their parent, or will it be a beneficial choice, or will it deteriorate it, or will it add to the risk factor or their job security or their power to have to be, because the maker of the WhatsApp, he sell WhatsApp to Facebook, but there are many security glitches in Facebook for sure, and recently WhatsApp users also very much
have issues.
Yes, ma'am.
Palak, as far as I understand, there are two questions in this. One, how a CEO can ensure that his job security is there and he has the rights which is there. So first of all, the seller needs to understand, the seller of the company needs to understand whether that person wants to be part of the company or not. All right. So when a buyer buys a company, there has to be, first of all, understanding whether the person wants to buy the company or wants to buy the person who has built the company. There's a difference. When I just want the company, I might not want the CEO or the founder of that particular company in that sense. So in that case, even if the founder is ready that, okay, I don't want to be part of the company anymore, I have done my job, I just want to retire or I want to start another company. So then nothing comes into picture. Then the entire risk issue, everything is a it lies on the head of the acquirer. There's no liability any further on the head of the seller. There are a few terms and conditions that are signed when they are signing the NDA, non-disclosed agreements, or the purchase agreements. When they sign the agreements, there are a few terms and conditions that are signed there. If the seller wants to make sure that the privacy policies should not be breached, even if he has sold his company, in the case of WhatsApp sold to the Facebook, if the WhatsApp owner would have signed it in the agreement that even if I'm not part of this company after it is sold off, it should make sure, the acquirer should make sure that the personal information breach should not be done. If the Facebook breaches that point, then they can be dragged to the court. But that is only possible when there's certain conditions or terms mentioned in the signing papers. So anything and everything that you want, that should be there in the terms of job security or the policies or the risk that should be taken care of. You need to put them down in the agreement paper. And if the acquirer agrees to those points, then he will sign the papers and then only you will sign the papers. If there's some discrepancies in the agreements on any point, either of you can walk away from the deal. So it's all about everything has to be written down. You cannot just have a verbal confirmation. If you want to be part of the team, you want certain powers as a CEO, you need to put them down in the agreement. And if the acquirer agrees to your terms, then only you will go for that acquisition. Otherwise, as I discussed in the earlier slides, that I'll just show you. So if you go to this slide, there are certain strategies that are written post pre-offer defense and post-offer defense. As a target, if you don't agree to the point that, you know, acquirer is not ready to take down your points into consideration, you can offer these, you can often opt these defense mechanisms to not go ahead for the acquisition if the acquirer is being hostile, that no, I want to take this company. If they're being hostile, then you can opt for these mechanisms. In this, there's a term called golden parachute. So golden parachute is a technique where this, when you know, when you don't want that, you know, the company is being sold off. So then what you do, you link higher compensation for the top management. That if the company is terminated, these managements will be compensated with so and so much of amount. So in such cases, you kind of, you know, you ensure your job security. You ensure that the CEO is still part of the company. Because if the compensation is way too high for the acquirer to pay, he would as much as would want to keep you in the company rather than letting you go, right? So everything has to be written down in the contract. Everything has to be properly read by both the target and the acquirer. And once it is signed, and if it is written as a term in your agreement, it will, you can take the person to the court if the term has been breached.
Do I answer
your question?
Yes, ma'am. It was quite satisfactory. And yeah, ma'am, so it means that the favorites of the CEO, they will, he will mention or she will mention them in the, in that agreement for a golden parachute. So maybe the favorites or the, or the, or the people who are very important for the company. Correct. Not all, or not general section will be.
Correct. So there are companies which also do sign it in the contract that, you know, we don't want our employees to be, we don't want our employees to leave the company post the acquisition. So in that case, if the acquirer agrees to that point and signs the paper, they will have to, take care of all the employees then, even the acquisition is done. So if they hire, if they fire any employee post the acquisition, the seller can drag them to the court. Again,
I mean, such a situation, if a situation like this, like COVID situation occurs, then also because many companies are rehabilitating or they are doing such things, like so people are people are losing their jobs. So will these people be will these people be safe from this kind of situation also?
Palak, it totally depends. If it is written in the, see, COVID situation is not something that was predetermined, right? Everything and anything is written in the contract. If obviously this is not written in the contract, then the acquirer can easily let go of the people, and he can always quote. And in that cases, what the acquirer can do, he might just fire people from his own company and the company that he has acquired, saying that the COVID times are tough on us, we cannot keep so many people. So it totally depends on the agreement that has been signed, but you cannot ensure that during COVID also people are not fired, because this is something nobody can help. What if, okay, they don't fire, but they won't give you money. What will you do in that case? So it depends on, you know, which, it totally depends on one, when the seller is selling the company, what all terms and conditions are important to the seller. Even for the employees, it totally makes sense. Say if Ratan Tata kind of a person, for him, humanity is very important as far as we understand, right? So maybe a person like him, when he sells his company, he'll make sure that all his employees are properly compensated. If they are let go of the company, if they are still, if they are there, then they are part of the company for next 5 years. They cannot, you know, they cannot be fired. So he will make sure all these points, but probably every seller won't do that, right? So it totally depends. Definitely during these mergers and acquisitions, employees suffer, because it depends how many they lose their job, because not many companies make sure that it's mentioned in the contract and they are taken care of. These things are not normally mentioned. Totally depends on the company, right? So definitely employees do suffer, but we can't do anything about it unless you are on the top management and you make sure that it is put in the contract.
Yeah, Yeah, and Janine Nimisha, it is seen that acquiring company, they take care of the employees of the company which they are actually going to acquire. In many other countries, what we see that the company which has been acquired, their employees also go to the court that without our consent, without our information,
exactly,
the company has been sold. And now we are not having many options. These
so
are
that is what they do. So even in many cases, employees prefer that it is written in the employment contract that for next 5 years, even if the merger happens, I will be part of the company. Like, you know, this doesn't, I'm not sure in I haven't come across any such documents so far, but such cases are there. That is why they can go to the court. And definitely employees suffer, and that's why they go to the court that we were not informed, because at times a deal happens in a very closed room and nobody gets to know outside the top management that, okay, we are already part of another company now.
And Nimisha, unless it is not a takeover, na, generally yeah, they take care of their employees.
Mostly, yes, because if somebody is acquiring another company, they are acquiring the whole company, which includes people as well. The company is made out of the people only. So if the people are not there, probably, you know, the company that they've acquired will not be successful. So 99%, they definitely want to acquire the company along with the people, unless there's some redundancy in any departments, in any particular segment, which they have to reduce the size. That's all.
Yeah, any other question, please, from the participants? Nimisha, one basic question, actually, I just want to ask that you were talking about the comparable ratios in which EV upon sales, EV upon revenue we were discussing.
Yeah.
So what is first calculated, the ratio or the EV?
So what we do, sir, first of all, when we do comparable ratios, we normally try to find out the companies which have the revenues which are there. We don't calculate the EV first. EV, we first calculate the revenue of those companies which are there, public companies, right? The comparables can only be done because they are publicly listed companies and they have their enterprise values, right? So now we calculate the EV by revenue from that particular numbers. We have the EV of the public companies. We have the revenues of the public companies. We get the EV by revenue as a ratio of these companies. We take an average of these companies. Say if I'm analyzing a consumer company, then probably I'll take the public companies as P&G, Colgate, you know, any all those Hindustan Unilever. So I'll take these companies. I'll take their EV by revenue. The average that I'll have, I'll apply that average to my revenue, this year's revenue or next year's revenue, whichever seems more feasible. And then I'll arrive to the enterprise value of my own company.
That is A by B is equal to C by D. And we are finding C.
Yeah, correct. Then we are finding the C.
Thanks. Any other question from the participants? If not, Nimisha, thanks a lot. A real thanks to you.
Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure for me to attend this session and, discuss certain things that I knew, and more than happy to attend it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks.